looking at me, but I realize you're looking at the trophies. So I'm the last speaker, and you'll get to those pretty soon. I'm going to switch a little bit. I'm not going to talk about entrepreneurship and business plans and stuff like that. But I am going to follow a little bit the logic of rural environments. And I'm going to show you some fun videos so you wake up before your trophies. I've been working with the World Food Program at the United Nations for almost 10 years. And my specialty is basically making our projects work. And that's anywhere in emergencies or in preparing for emergencies or making rural livelihoods work and so that they can resist emergencies better. When I say emergencies, I mean cyclones, droughts, and floods, which are very common here in Asia, as the most disaster-prone region in the world. So for this presentation, the one thing I want to do is I'm going to show you some of the difficulties I've had with working in this environment, and then I'm going to throw you a little challenge, and I'm just going to let you marinate on that later as you get your trophies. So humanitarian innovation has changed quite a bit in the last 20 years. I've been in it for the last 10 years, and one of the things that has changed a lot is it's not business as usual. We used to intervene a lot in rural areas, thinking that this is where people are more prone to disasters. And what I've noticed in the last 9-10 years, and what the World Bank data shows us, is that most livelihoods and most of the work people actually do is now moving into the urban areas. And a few of the startups today actually came up with that and tried to come up with solutions. So I'm constantly worried now about what we're going to do about that new workforce entering urban areas that are not skilled in anything but farming livelihoods or aquaculture or pastoralism. And I see it every day. Every time I was just in Bangladesh in the rural areas, and the government says, well, this is fine, we can improve the yields, but what are you going to do about all these people moving to Dhaka? I don't know. I don't have an answer, right? And there's a few ways of working around it. So I realize that not many of you might know what humanitarian work entails. So my first question to you all is, what humanitarian means, what humanitarian work means? What does humanitarian work mean, anyone? Helping humans. Helping humans, very good. I had my own idea of what humanitarian work was. It's now changed and all sophisticated now, and like when it exceeds the skills of the people in the community, then we intervene, and that's our humanitarian work. But I'm going to show you a little video that's a bit old school, and I like that it's old school because you can see the transition of what we do now and what we used to do. Oops. If you can show the YouTube one, and I'll get out of your way.
If you thought this is what aid work is all about, then think again. No roads, no maps, saving lives in uncharted territory. Confronting every challenge along the way.
You never know what is happening in the desert. I'm getting fed up with goat meat and sheep meat and goat meat and sheep meat. Something different is nice. Here we don't have new parts, we don't have new dealers. so we do it ourselves.
A race against time across the Libyan desert. And tsunami on the front line of the relief effort. Join them in some of the world's roughest spots. Get to know the people who spend their lives bringing relief to those who need it most.
Selfless, what is it? Selfish self-promotion. But what I wanted to flag from the video, apart from it being old school, because we now have maps and we have a bunch of tech that we use now, is the fact that those challenges actually remain, is the connection to markets, having the right data. All that stuff is still out there in some of the most remote areas in the world, but surprisingly also in areas that we still access easily in the United Nations. And so the need for innovation in this environment is really just staggering. And the two things I get a lot is a ton of bad pitches because so many people want to help, but I get really bad solutions for problems that don't exist. And the other problem is, when we do get a solution that we do want, how do we make it something that we can actually sustain? Startups can generate funding through venture capitalism and all that, but we have to rely on volunteer donations, and we also have rely on governments, donor governments, for completely voluntary-based funding. So the way you build your business is very different. And how to bring in those solutions is much tougher, at least in my view. And there's very little room to discuss these things in the startup world. So I look at very basic things to understand which innovations are good or bad in our space. We look at viability, like I was just saying. How viable is your idea? How are you going to get the money? So we had somebody pitch us a containerized farming solution for training farmers. And again, this is upskilling the workforce in the rural areas. And by the end of it, they told us, well, each container is $50,000. And how many do you need? Oh, we need like 100 containers just for one container. It's impossible. So you have to make the solution work for the area and the context. It's another one was solar power drip irrigation, which sounds fantastic, but it's super expensive. And everybody's doing drip irrigation already with Pepsi bottles cut in half, which is like 100 times less of the price. So viable means simple, cheap, and look at your context. We got another pitch, housing for post-emergency situations. Now, the one thing you're thinking after Hurricane Haiyan in the Philippines was it's very hot, it's very humid, and the pitch we got, they didn't have ventilation in the housing, it was terrible, it wasn't working. So it has to be feasible, and the materials were not sourceable out there. So again, it might be feasible in other contexts, but the humanitarian context is completely different. And the last part, so desirability. Do we want the things that people are pitching to us? And of course, we want all the help we can get, but a lot of times when we try to implement something, and this has happened quite a bit and it's our fault, we fail miserably because we're not as good as filtering things. We get a lot of pitches for blockchain stuff. I had to train myself in blockchain to try to push them away. But desirability. We wanted a way to get transfers to Syrian refugees in the camps, which we feed every day, about 1 million of them. We wanted a way to get food to the refugees in the camps in a cheaper way. About 3 years ago, we were doing it through financial service providers, and it was costing us quite a bit for people to go with a voucher or a card to get their food. So one of our guys actually went out there and found a solution through blockchain, actually, but that was 2016. It was scalable, and it brought our costs down 98% in terms of the payment we had to give the financial service provider. So that was a really good innovation. It still has its flaws. So it went from 100 refugees benefiting from the payment rails to 500,000 refugees this year are going on the blockchain platform on Ethereum with the World Food Program. And now we're bringing everybody in, because that's one thing in the humanitarian world. If it works, everybody please copy us, right? Like, just spread the word. And the other thing that we were pitched is, this wasn't Alibaba, but somebody was trying to pitch us something similar, was the robotics, warehouse robotics. So we run 7 large hubs for emergency operations around the world for the humanitarian community. We are the logistics leader. So every time there's an emergency, when the tsunami happened, we're the first ones in, and the hub in Malaysia and Kuala Lumpur is the one that sends all the goods. So somebody was saying, well, why don't you use the robots that Kroger and Alibaba are using in their warehouses? What are we going to do with hundreds of thousands of dollars of robots in a warehouse that's not moving anything when there's no emergencies, right? So we just hire 20 guys when there's an emergency that works. So we got to think cheap and efficient. And so I have a question for you guys. Now that we're thinking desirability, feasibility, and viability, and cheap, you saw that helicopter in the beginning. That's, I think, $4,000 or something per hour to deliver goods to very remote locations in mountain areas. Trucks are cheaper, but they can't get across mud and rainy terrains, and we have that problem in a lot of monsoon areas here in Asia. What's a solution that comes to mind that is cheaper to deliver goods to remote areas in floody, muddy situations and such? Oh, what is it? Horses. Very good. Actually, that's genius. High five. Because everybody was insisting in Nepal after the earthquake that we do all this fancy stuff with helicopters. What did the Nepalese suggest? Donkeys, and just pack the monkeys, and we'll get the mountaineers and the Sherpas to get all the food across. So we had thousands of Sherpas carrying food on their backs, but also the donkeys up to the mountain areas, while all the other people were suggesting fancy stuff. Just kind of shut up. But we did something a little bit more. This is very recent, by the way, but we just got a better car. And this is what it looks like. Oops, sorry. You can hit play on that.
We're working in many places which are very hard to reach, which are cut off by the floods, which are with the rainy seasons, with no roads. And you can imagine a mother with a child which needs the food, and WFP cannot reach them so easily.
So this Sherp is hopefully going to give us access to move the more nutritious foods that they may need to be able to survive.
This is why we are in Uganda now, to train our drivers and fleet managers how to use this equipment to respond to emergencies. Benefit of Sherp is that it can reach almost anywhere.
And it carries 1.2 tons. It can basically drive up and down hills. It floats on water.
It consumes only 4 liters per 1 hour of drive. So that means that one full tank, we can go almost 500-600 kilometers on the hardest terrain.
And it's able to deliver food at a cost-efficient rate. When we compare it with helicopters, this is about $200 a ton, and a helicopter is about $4,000 a ton. We're on the shores of Lake Victoria, trying to simulate the settings that we would be putting this Sherp into in our environment to do the deliveries. We've had drivers from South Sudan and training them how to use it, see how the drivers handle it, make sure we know how to maintain it before we put it into live settings inside South Sudan.
I'm Richard Gama from South Sudan. This truck is going to help WFP South Sudan a lot. Now we come to train, and the first people from South Sudan, they come to train this.
We are very grateful to our donors. We want to ensure that we care about every dollar we spend, and we maximize the funds we are getting to ensure that more food is being delivered for the amount of money we are receiving. WFP is continuously innovating and implementing the best industry standards in our operation. We are the leader in humanitarian logistics. We are an example that is followed by others. This is why we are continuously developing and continuously providing solutions in logistics.
This job maybe is going to help a lot. We will not be stuck to delivering food for people. We are going to deliver food for them.
Okay, so I didn't make the car, but thank you. Actually, that was a pitch to us. We didn't actually engineer the car, but somebody came up to us and said, hey, we use this for extreme sports. Do you guys want them? Yeah, and like, yeah, sure. It's cheap. It's great. So now we're trying to integrate it in monsoon situations. So what I gather from all this last 10 years and a few other colleagues from other organizations who are looking into changing the way things are done is with this mindset, which is a bit simplified, but cheap, viable, desirable, etc., is we have a group of sectoral experts and we filter innovations through it. We just started this year. We had two or three clients that we did it for free. And our whole idea is to get the right innovation in the right hands, innovations that actually work. And we will work with you to make them work if they pass a certain amount of scrutiny. So write me, come to me, and talk to me. We're happy. Me and my co-founder, she's from Oxfam. She's one of the founders of the Oxfam Blockchain Foundation, which gets a lot more attention than I do. But yeah, we're ready to talk to you anytime. Thank you.